Professor Stella, back when I was in college and we did music history, the way that 19th century romantic music was described was that it had greater freedom of form, as we just talked about earlier. It had chromatic harmonies, more dissonances, daring modulations. Did 19th century Partimento, and we're talking now about Platania and Raimondi, did they add these characteristics to Partimento?
So, first of all, I think we have to distinguish about among two different kind of chromatism. There is a subsidiary or accessorial chromaticism, that is to say, an ornamental chromaticism, as quite often you can see, for example, in the music of Chopin. And that is another kind of chromaticism that go more in depth in the musical composition.
Is that melodically in terms of the way the diminutions are, the notes in between?
Yeah, that is.
We're not talking about the harmony here. We're talking about kind of like the melodic lines.
Okay. And the second one that is more in depth because it's about the structure of music. And so this is another kind of chromaticism. So Platania tried really to introduce in the practice of Partimento the first type of chromaticism, but you can hardly find the second one. The second one was in some sense out of the Neapolitan tradition.
The second one is the harmony, the chords.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You can find obviously some chromatic chords, but introduced always under a counterpointal point of view. This is another element. For example, all the European theorists had to travel a lot to justify theoretically all the chromatic harmony, because in some sense they feel that the chromatic harmony could broke the stability of tonality.
Let's get an example here. So this is 19th century harmony. We're not talking about Debussy. We're not talking about Ravel. We're talking about perhaps like Chopin and Schumann and that sort of thing.
For example, the augmented triad chord, no? Or were written treatises about it, how to justify the use of these chords that the composer used, but the problem was in the school, how to give a theoretical justification to this kind of chord.
The augmented chord, so the raised fifth.
For example, okay. in the Liszt, for example, in the Lisztians, but Platania used this kind of chords, but in some sense is like it was more facilitated in this use, looking at this under a counterpointal point of view. If I look not vertically at music, but horizontally, so if are the melodic movement that creates this kind of chords, it is less problematic. Because if the horizontal movements are correct, I have no need to give an explanation for everything.
So if we could try and explain that technically, for instance, there's in the Neapolitan method, I mean, in the Partimento, you have dissonances, the 4, 7, and the 9, but they have to be prepared. Is that one characteristic of the 19th century? And if we're talking horizontally, you don't have to prepare some of these dissonances?
Not always. Not always, because, for example, Platania in his harmony treatise says that in some situations the dissonances.
Oh, he has a harmony treatise. Okay, so people can download that.
Yeah. There is a an harmony treatise. I believe it's now free in the digital materials of the Italian SBN.
That's cool.
He says, for example, that in some situations, dissonances may be not prepared or not resolved if they are hidden by other voices. There are some situations in which dissonances are not so openly audible. So he stressed a lot the importance of hearing what I'm really able to hear. Music is not done for reading, it's done for hearing. So if I'm not able to distinguish the movement of this dissonance, what's the problem?
So you're saying that you have more freedom, but you have to make sure the voices allow for it to either hide it so that it's not... is that what you're saying?
Yeah, in some sense, yes. Yeah. If the dissonance is hidden by another voice that has more importance for a rhythmic reason.
What do you mean by hidden? So you really
have
to explain, because I'm not an expert. So hidden means
that in the perception, when you hear, there are some dissonance that are really quite evident. No, because they are accented, for example, or because they are in a strong position or in the top voice. Well, so in these cases, you have to put really a lot of care in the use of dissonances. But in other cases, when there is another voice that take the importance on it, so the dissonance in some sense is shadowed in the perception. So if you are not I know it's quite a different idea of harmony. So, yeah, if the dissonance is shadowed, if it's not so important in the perception, how I have to take care of it?
Do you resolve them? Do you have to, like, leading tone has to rise and that sort of thing, and fourth scale,
the leading tone, obviously, Platania was very strict about the tradition. So the leading tone, the seventh chord has their normal resolution. But it showed some cases in which it was possible to avoid the strict rules using the principle of what I am hearing. If it's possible to hear or not. If it is not, what's the matter?
Right. Now, you mentioned that Raimondi, his theoretical works, there was a romantic nature to it.
Raimondi was quite different by his pupil Platania. For example, in his pedagogical works, he was really quite strict. His exercises in... Of partimenti, bassi imitati e fugati, and so on, were quite strict in the use of the rules. It was perhaps more tied to the tradition. But in my opinion, and it was one of the reasons I put Raimondi together with Platania and Boucheron in my article of the Journal of Music Theory. Raimondi participated too in the movement of shifting in the Partimento tradition in the 19th century. For example, he was one of the first to carry the Partimento in the written out form. For example, his Bassi Imitati e Fugati was written for a written out realization, not for an improvised one. So in this sense, he was one of the romantic composers of partimenti, because the partimento, as I said before, became a written out practice. But the style, no, is another thing. Platania, yeah, it was completely a composer of his time, even if a little bit pedantic sometimes, but anyway, a composer of his times.
And what do you mean by that?
He began to write when he was young as a bel canto composer, and when he was old, he ended his career in a style quite close to the verismo.
What is that? What's that? The later style? Could you repeat that again?
Verismo.
Verismo. What is like, verismo?
Like Giordano, Cilea, Mascagni.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Okay, so during his career, he really followed the style of his times. So he was born in the 1828. He died in the 1907, And so he followed the different styles of the different epochs. Raimondi was more conservative, was more really more tied, but to the old times in some sense.
If we can talk about figured and unfigured basses, Platanea apparently was adamant on unfigured basses more than his teacher. But he is also more of a 19th century, in the vein of a 19th century composer compared to his teacher. So if he's doing unfigured basses, is the harmony still kind of conservative, or would you have more different harmonies, even though it is unfigured?
Platania shared with his maestri the opinion that the pupil had to be able to realize partimento without figures. He says it clearly in the introduction of his treatise of harmony. But in the meantime, he shared with his teacher Raimondi the idea that each partimento. But it was the same in the past. Each partimento may be realized at different levels of difficulties. So there is always an easy way to realize a partimento, and increasingly more complex ways to realize a partimento. So obviously the starting point is the same. If you look at the treatise of Platania, you can find the cadences, the rule of the octave, and so on. So the identical stuffs.
Is it identical then, Professor Stella, or are there such things as like a 19th century way of doing a cadence, a romantic way of doing the rule of the octave, a more elaborated cadence? Do you know what I mean? So like, for instance, more romantic stylings, romantic patterns.
There are some, but at more advanced level. The basis remains quite the same as in Fenaroli. But at the more advanced level, you can find some suggestions, for example, of a more chromatic realization of the rule of the octave, of some kind of suspensions. But are mostly of the first kind of chromaticism I spoke about. So it's a melodic way to an ornamental, a melodic way. I spoke about Chopin, for example, because Chopin did quite often use of partimento patterns in his compositions.
Can you give some examples of that?
For example, the very beginning of the Etude Opus 25, number 2. The very beginning of the etude is a rule of the octave. It's based on the rule of the octave. The problem, cool. if you want to call this way, is that the rule of the octave is hidden inside a lot of notes of a figuration, a lot of diminution, if you want. So it's a romantic way to diminish the rule of the octave. But if you cross out all the ornamental notes, you can find purely a festav of the first with 3-5, second degree with 6-4-3, and so on. For in the fantasy, F minor fantasy for piano, you can find some examples of the 6-5 progression.
Or the Moti del Basso, the 6-5?
Yeah, the Moti del Basso, that is.
Can we do a few more? I'm sure the audience would love that. If we could just mention more examples of 19th century music where they are clear partimento patterns.
You know that the beginning of the impromptu number, opus 142, number 2, if I remember well, the A flat major by Franz Schubert. This is another good example of a rule of the octave. Mi, la, la, si, la, sol, si, si, la, si, do. It's a totally rule of the octave-based theme, but Giuseppe Verdi, Va pensiero sulle ali dorate from Nabucco, is a rule of the octave the same. But in my opinion, it's not really surprising. If you want to speak about the rule of the octave, rule of the octave was one of the first rules that every pupil in composition learned in that times. So what was more obvious to use that one of the first things you learned. It's like I'm speaking with you and I'm speaking mostly using subject verb.
Yep.
what is surprising about this? It's normal. It was the first thing I learned when I was a child, subject and verb. So the rule of the octave was the same. It's a good confirm on what was quite normal. When I do piano lessons, I listen to my pupils play, and sometimes I say, oh, but this is another rule of the octave. So another one, yeah. At the beginning of the first Lied ohne Worte by Felix Mendelssohn.
These are the rules that you see, like, for instance, in Fenaroli, you can find them. How do they cover it up in the 19th century? What kind of romantic dressing do they put over these old patterns?
You can see very well, really, in the music of Chopin, for example. Chopin, you know that... Has been written out really tons of words about the classicity of Chopin, no? Of how Chopin was a classical order, different from the other romantics. In some sense, it was often described like a kind of pupil of Mozart.
But, and Bach too, right? Yeah,
But nowadays, it's really interesting to see that we are able to go more in depth to this kind of classicism. It was really related to his education. He was a Poland, so he was born in a Catholic country. Catholicism, obviously, in that times means Italy. it means a strong link with Italian culture and Italian tradition. You know that Felix Dirgarten, for example, studied quite in depth these aspects about the apprenticeship of the young Chopin. They found that the education of Chopin was quite strongly influenced by the Italian tradition. So now we can answer to the classical manner to behave of Chopin in composition. And in the most part of his compositions, if you cross out, as I said before, if you cross out all the chromatical diminution, you can find that the basis, the fundamentals of these compositions remained quite the same of the past. Really, I say nothing about his genius in the way to use that old stuff. Nobody may discuss about this, but anyway, the language was the same, was quite the same with a new dressing, as you said before, but it was the same. Today, in my opinion, many people are stressing a lot the aspect of improvisation, obviously the importance that the 18th century tradition had, but it is, in some sense, self-demonstrated, this kind of importance. It's a fact. But in my opinion, it's quite interesting the same to look at what occurred during the 19th century, how this tradition adapted to a new kind of professionalism, because the problem is not to say if the past is better, the present is worse, so we can continue to...
Oh, it's so bad. It's so bad right now.
That is. So, in my opinion, it's more interesting to look to what occurred and which was the relation between what was needed by a professional during the 19th century what and how the education changed to give answers to the new necessities.
That's a great, because I really want to ask you about the way you teach Partimento. Maybe we can get to that very quickly. I just have one more question about the 19th century, and that deals with the second part of the chromaticism that we didn't, that the structure and the harmony. I know in the Paris Conservatory, for instance, Nadia Boulanger, when she was teaching with the Paul Vidal basses, do we see something like that in Partimenti of Raimondi or maybe Boucheron or that they would, the structurally, the second type of chromaticism.
You can find something, but it's quite hard to define. For example, not in the Neapolitan, among the Neapolitans, but if you look, for example, the Partimenti of Boucheron, you find a more chromatic way to use Partimenti, but in some sense they are Partimenti just in name, because Raimondi wrote this particular kind, Boucheron wrote this kind of particular Partimenti with the numbers, not only, but with the realization. So you have a double sheet of paper. In the first one, you have the exercise. In the second one, you have the realization. And in the first one, the numbers describe exactly the position of the hands. So you have to do nothing than to look for notes on the keyboard. It's quite a strange way to look at the world of Partimenti, but it is explained by what occurred in that years in Milan when Boucheron lived. Milan, you know, was conquered by Napoleon in the first half of 19th century, and it was founded in Milan a conservatory really French oriented. The conservatory was founded by the French. The books adopted in the conservatory were the translation of the books used in the Paris conservatory.
That's weird. So the Naples conservatories, they influenced Paris. And now Paris is,
and Paris is
yeah. backwards now.
Yeah. So even if some teachers from Naples went to teach in Milan, the same Milan remained a strongly French-oriented conservatory. So the method they used were quite different from the method of Naples. And you can see this a really different way in the Partimenti by Boucheron. And this way was followed by another, in this case, is a Florentine organist, Tacchinardi, who wrote another collection of Partimenti some years later than Boucheron, another collection of organ Partimenti, in the same way, so with the numbers that describe the position of hands on the keyboard. And they are very chromatic Partimenti, but the organist had simply to look for notes on the keyboard, because the numbers are all written out. So
can you do that with unfigured basses? And can you get kind of like a romantic harmony without figures?
Yeah, if you are trained for it, probably they did, yeah. Organist overall. For example, improvisation in the Italian conservatories at the end of the 19th century disappeared, but was maintained for the organists. They had to continue to study improvisation.
Italian organists.
Italian organists. And it remained as a subject of study until present.
The French organists and the Italian organists, from what you're telling me, they improvise. And is that the way they do it? Could you call that Partimenti? So they are doing Partimento? 19th century harmony, yeah.
The Italians continue to have an apprehension in Partimento during the 19th century. All the Italian composers in the 19th century had to study and to learn Partimento, not only in Naples, but in the north too. If you think that Verdi studied with Vincenzo Lavigna. Lavigna was a pupil of Fenaroli. So we know that also Pietro Mascagni. Mascagni studied in Milan, but with Saladino. Saladino was a pupil of Pietro Raimondi, so he had to study Partimenti too.
So I guess for us to anchor this, yes, there was 19th century Partimenti, the way it was kind of done just like 18th century Partimenti, but in a 19th century style. People did do it. It started to change into written forms, but the organists were still doing kind of a 19th century Partimenti. And were they, the organists, were they figuring their basses, or did they You mentioned this just now, right? They did figure the bass.
I have to admit that I didn't study in depth this aspect. I met the figure of Tacchinardi only occasionally for his collection of Partimenti. I believe anyway that the fact that they had to learn Partimento after really influenced their practice. The same, so it wasn't possible to cross out this kind of experience and to do totally in a totally different way after a training like this.
Quick question, Professor Stella: can you do 19th century harmony without thinking of the modern harmony? So, for instance, thinking like figured bass, thinking like basso continuo partimento theory, and not thinking of the fundamental bass, not thinking of chordal invertibility. Is that possible?
It's my opinion, it's easier.
So it is definitely possible, and it's easier is what you're saying. And we're talking 19th century harmony.
For example, you know that in 18th century, two Napolitan maestros knew quite soon the new theories, the new French theories from Rameau and others about the fundamental bass,
yeah,
and so on. They knew because we know that copies of the French treatises arrived in Naples quite soon, but they refused this kind of theory because it was really hard for them to understand why I have to consider a kind of now I'm going to joke a little. Why have I to consider a ghost bus? And for a ghost bus, I want to say a bus that I cannot hear. A not existing bus, a theoretical bus,
yeah,
instead of the real one. the real one is what I hear. The bus fundamental is the ghost,
<It's a> ghost.
The missing one. it's something that I have to reconstruct by thoughts, but not by practice. So what utility may I have in this kind of approach was still alive in the 19th century. Previously, I forgot to say that when I spoke about tonal counterpoint, I forgot to say that at the very beginning of the 19th century, in the first two decades, there was quite a strange situation in which they wrote tonally, but they continued to use the modal theory. If you look, for example, at the counterpoint treatise by Tritto, you can find that he continued to say "Ala mi re, G sol fa ut," and all the other stuffs of the models,
old school stuff,
of the models, modal theory and modal solfège, but in a tonal context. So the theoric language remained the same of the past, but the practice changed. So when we speak about the romantic way to do Partimento, it's something like that. The fundamentals of theory remain the same of the 18th century, but the way to realize it, and in some sense, they preserved the
system,
the idea. Yeah, the system, the ideas. For example, to train the composers in the real form of music. This is an idea. Obviously, the idea was used differently in the times. So, which were the forms used in the 18th century? Fugue, concertos, and so on. And they did partimenti in concerto form. Which were the forms used in 19th century? Impromptu, romanza. Romanza. For example, at the very end of Platania treatise, you can find the realization by himself of a romanza partimento, an ABA form, ABA form, excuse me, an ABA form in the style of Bo, perhaps something in the middle of Mendelssohn and some easy composition of Schumann. It's a completely a piano piece of music, so real music.